So, the tower defense game is actually coming along pretty nicely. But, like I said in the first episode, there are some major bugs with our movement system. As you can see, look how slow the enemies go on this left side versus the right side. There is no consistency at all. And I mean, obviously, you want to keep the speed, what the enemies are walking, the same, no matter how far their distance is. Also, as you can see over here, the enemies also don't turn yet, so it looks very weird. They just keep looking the same way, which is kinda weird. So, this episode, we're gonna fix the movement speed, fix rotations, and I got a very special little sneak peek for you guys, because I need you guys' input on something very important. But we do that after the code. So the first thing that I want to fix right now is that the easing style was the wrong easing style. So we need to put the easing style to linear. This is just as a, you know, it looks nicer. So right now the easing style is automatically set to quad, and if you put it on linear, the enemies just go a lot smoother through the entire core, so make sure to put that in. But the first thing that we're gonna do is make the enemies turn towards the next node. So first we need to find the previous node, obviously, since we linked all the nodes together inside a big list, is the parent. So local parent node equals node.parent. And I just realized I misspelled node over here, but we're just gonna leave it be because we're cool programmers. So to rotate the entity, we're gonna do the following. First, I wanna make a new variable all the way at the top called rotation speed. And for now, we're gonna set it to, let's set it to 5. It's way too much, but at least you will see what the code does. So what we're going to do to rotate is we first need to make a C frame value that holds our C frame, because we need to find you know, the data of the C frame. So we're gonna make a local C frame data equals cframe.new, and we're gonna start off at the parent node.position, and then the next value is node.position. So position. So what this is going to do, it's gonna take the parent node at which we are currently standing, and it's gonna look at the next node. And looking at is the important keyword over here. Then all we're gonna do is we're gonna set up a tween again, a rotation tween with the tween service. Okay, so let's actually test that out. I haven't tested it out yet, so let's turn around and let's see. And as you can see, they are slowly turning, but yeah, they're taking like 5 seconds to turn, so we're getting these really weird shapes everywhere. So yeah, that's what I meant, like 5 seconds is way too long. We're probably gonna turn it down to like 0.5 and see what that does. You know what? I still think 0.5 is too slow. I think they should turn a lot faster. I think 0.5 is way too slow. Ooh, that sucked. But what you can see is that they actually face upwards and downwards when they're going on a slope. So that is pretty, pretty cool. Let me turn it down a little bit more. I think I like that. It is at 0.2 right now, so they don't really stop. They just go and turn, come and turn, go and turn. So the only problem we still face right now is that, well, they go way too fast and way too slow. Like, the speed is not consistent at all. So before we take a look at that little sneak peek, let's actually fix the speed right away. So before we can actually do the math, we actually need to know how far these two points are away from each other. Because if we don't know how far they away they are, we have no idea how fast the cube should be going. So let's first find out how fast they all go. I just completely brain fried myself. I obviously meant, let's see what the distance is between the two nodes. I just said that and it completely brain freezed my mind, okay? Let's find out how far away the nodes are. So now that we have the distance, I believe all we have to do is just do distance times speed. And this should give all the cubes the exact same speed, no matter how long they have to travel. Here we go, let's see if something breaks. Oh wait, it actually broke, huh? No! Poseidon. Poseidon is not a valid member. Huh, it's obviously position. Position, not Poseidon, it's position. Okay. Second try. Let's see. Okay, so they're all going a lot slower. And yeah, they're going the same speed. Let's go. And they turn really, really nice. Oh, look at this. It's starting to look like a tower defense game. I think they need to be a little bit faster though, because that's a lot of cubes. Wait. Let me turn it up a little bit. And then we see how it will actually look like. Okay, so I increased the speed by 2 and this looks a lot better. Look at this! It's actually starting to look like a nice, nice tower defense. Speaking of looks, while I really want to make a tower defense game, I have no idea what kind of style I want to do. So, because I got really, really excited for this project, I created a style in my private workspace that I really want to show you guys and ask feedback on. I think it would be a pretty cool style because I haven't seen any other tower defense game, you know, use this style. So, yeah, let's take a look at what I made. So this is what I made. I haven't seen a single tower defense game use this kind of art style with like the very blocky, very clean style. Obviously, there would need to be a lot more decorations, but this is just to get the art style down. It would obviously have a lot more detail, but you know, just simple, vibrant colors. Like, everything is made out of blocks. So I got this little crab enemy here that I think looks pretty cool. So yeah, let me know if this is a style that you guys would like for the tower defense game. I personally think it looks really cool because, like I said, I haven't seen a single other tower defense use this style. So I think it could be pretty unique. In case you were wondering, this is how big everything would look with like a normal character. So like, you are the size of a tree, around a tree. And like, look how small and cute the enemies would be. And you can like, go up the ramps and you can like, fight the kingdom. Yeah, so obviously I didn't spend too much time on it, just on the crab and the castle. But like, if you guys want, I could totally work this out a little bit further and see what epic thing we could create, because oh, it could be so cool. You know what, one enemy is a little bit boring. Should we add another enemy? I think we should. The only problem is, how are we gonna do that? How are we gonna define its speed? How are we gonna define its health? Well, luckily there is something really, really useful for that. And it's called a module script. So I always use module scripts as database. So let's do entity data. There we go. And in this module script, we can absolutely go ham. So let's do module.data equals, and let's make a dictionary. And the first enemy we're gonna do is enemy Whoa, enemy one with some values. And we're gonna make enemy two with some values. So for now, the only value that we really need to pay attention to will be speed. And enemy one will have a speed of, let's say, 3. And enemy 2 will have a speed of, let's say, 10. So this is gonna be the very fast enemy, and this is gonna be the very slow enemy. So the first thing that's very important is that our main script needs to know that the database exists. So we're gonna do local entity data equals require game replicated storage entity data. And this means that this script needs the entity data script to function. So I created a new enemy. We got our default slow enemy and our fast enemy too. So now we need to have the system pick out which entity it's going to spawn. So we want to have the system pick out which enemy. So first we need to declare which enemies can you pick out. So we're going to do local options equals, and then we're going to do workspace.enemy1 and workspace.enemy2. Then here in our entity, it doesn't recognize the word enemy anymore. So what we are going to do is we're going to do options with these brackets and then match random one hashtag options and then clone. So now it will pick out enemy one or enemy two. And you know what? Let's test that out right now. So as you can see, it picks out either the red one or the blue one. But like you can see, they don't change speed yet. And that's pretty obvious because we haven't declared the speed yet. So let's actually set the speed for every little enemy so that the red enemies actually go faster than the blue enemies. So in our move enemy tab, we're gonna make a new variable called speed. And how are we gonna find the speed? It's actually pretty simple. Because our enemy has a name, we can simply go into our entity data in our data tag, and then we're gonna look for entity.name. So let's say this is enemy one. It's gonna look inside this enemy one table, and then we're gonna need to say, hey, can you please look for the speed for us and put it in the speed variable. Now that we have the speed variable, it's pretty easy. We can just time this speed by our other speed. And now you see something really weird. We're doing time speed by time speed. So let's change the speed that we just made to entity speed. And this speed also to entity speed. And honestly, this should work. Here we go, testing. Will it crash? Will it explode? Nobody knows. Okay, and we did that really fast. As you can see, the blue enemies go slow, red enemies go fast. And now, well, basically, they're just all ready to attack, all ready to go. Look at him go, he's going up. He's going down. This guy is going pretty slow. But yeah, this is super cool. Honestly, I wouldn't make any enemy faster than the red enemy we have right now, because that is very, very fast. Like, honestly, that is insanely fast. Now, the cool thing about this data store is that we literally can do so much things. We can declare health, you know, we can declare health, like maybe this one has 999 health. We can do other things like, is it a stealth unit? And we can do true, and then you can, oh, this enemy is a stealth unit. So you can basically put a lot of data inside this module and just ask for it in all your other scripts. This is an absolutely amazing, amazing feature. And if you never use the module scripts, I highly recommend that you start using them. And you know what? Since we have still a lot of time left, let's also program the HP for our cute player base. I am so sorry, cute player base, but you're gonna get hurt. So first in the player base, I wanna add a value, and we're gonna put in, let's do an int value, shall we? And we're gonna call this health. Now I'm gonna make a second billboard UI. You normally don't wanna make two billboard UIs into one because it doesn't make any sense. The reason why I'm gonna do that is simply because this is gonna be temporary anyway, but this tag above here is gonna display its health. So we're gonna do health bar, and we're gonna call this amount. Okay, very, very cool. So now we're gonna put inside our player base, we're gonna add a script, and we're gonna call that SCR_player health. So in here, we're gonna put all the variables. So we're gonna do local health value equals script parent.health. And then we're gonna do if health value dot changed, then we're gonna fire a function with its value. And what are we gonna do? We're gonna go to script parent health bar amount, and inside the text we're gonna do equals, and then we're gonna do two of these, and we're gonna do HP ... value. And now every time the health upgrades, it should display its HP value. So we already coded a reached end, and what reached end means is that it actually reached your exit point. So instead of typing reached end, we can do a lot in here. So first of all, we're gonna do entity destroy. We don't need this entity anymore. It's just in the world for nothing. So let's destroy our enemy. Once we destroy our enemy, we can go into workspace.playerbase.health.value-equals. How much damage should we like it to? Let's like it to 5 damage. And you know what? This little bar of code is literally it to make the health go down. This is all we had to do. And if you don't believe me, let's test it out. Let's spawn into the world, and you can see it has 200 HP. The fast cube is gonna come, and boom, it lost 5 HP. Now, obviously, when we reach 0 HP, nothing is gonna happen. We're not gonna game over because we haven't coded it yet. But this is a very, very fundamentally part of the tower defense genre. You need to have your HP go lowered. Now, what most tower defense games do is that they damage the player base based on the remaining HP that the enemy still has. And don't worry about it, we're still gonna code that. But for now, our enemies don't really have HP, so we can't really use the HP. And we're getting really close to 0 HP. And oh, we died and we're going in the negative. No! I really wanted to get all the small things out of the way so we can move over to the big stuff, like actual units, rounds, point collection, upgrading, all different kinds of enemies, bosses, wave systems, all that awesome, awesome stuff. Be sure to let me know if this is a cool style that you want to see the game in. And if you don't want to see the game in this style, let me know which style you would like for the game. Also guys, let me know in the comments which topic you want next video to be about. It could be about GUI, it could be about placing units, it could be about a wave system. All these kinds of stuff. Let me know what you want to see in the next episode. I really hope you're enjoying this devlog, but for now, I'm gonna head out. Thank you guys all for watching. Bye bye.